If everyone could be seated, please. If we could get everyone's attention. Good afternoon, everybody. I'm Bobby McKenzie. I'm the founding director of the Muslim Diaspora Initiative here at New America. And on behalf of New America, I want to welcome you and thank you for coming to today's discussion on two new reports by the Omran Center. Launches of this kind are fairly typical in Washington, D.C. What is not so typical is having two reports written by Syrian Americans who are running organizations that are doing an enormous amount of good to try and improve the lives of Syrians both in Syria and in the neighboring states. And I just want to take a minute to highlight first, an organization known as ARCS, the American Relief for Syria. This is an organization, or this is an umbrella organization that includes 13 Syrian-American humanitarian organizations. In 2015, they raised $51 million from private donors and another $71 million in grants. That's not an insignificant amount of money. With these resources, they helped 6 million displaced persons, 120 schools, and they reached nearly 150 hospitals. They've done work in the frontline states, namely Lebanon, Jordan, and Turkey, and also more recently in Europe. So these organizations have stepped up at a time when Syria has gone through enormous tumultuous transition. Syria is, by any standard, an engine of enormous suffering. Half of the country has been displaced. 500,000 people have lost their lives. There are now 5 million Syrian refugees who are in Lebanon, Jordan, and Turkey with no end in sight. And so I am thrilled to introduce today Dr. Ammar Kahf and Yaser Tabbara. They are the co-founders of the Omran Center for Strategic Studies. And just to put their organization in perspective within the wider ARCS organization, they have raised and distributed over $34 million in 2016 alone, and $75 million in both aid and development since 2013. So they have provided enormous support to both Syrians displaced Syrians, but also refugees in the frontline states. And it's worth noting just two more points here that I think are important. Is that they have they employ almost entirely Syrians. They employ around 1,100 individuals, and they told me earlier today that of that 1,100, only two are non-Syrians. It's not that they're discriminating, but they're trying to do everything that they can to tap into the knowledge and expertise of Syrians, but also empower Syrians to be the masters of their own destiny as much as reasonably possible. And I also was thrilled to hear that because of their efforts in Turkey, they have created 7,500 jobs in Turkey. That is no small feat. So I'm going to briefly introduce each one. They're going to come up here one by one. They are going to say some really smart things, but I'm going to ask that you hold off on questions until the very end. So first, Ammar Kahf, Dr. Ammar Kahf is going to come up and give a presentation. He is the executive director of the Omran Center for Strategic Studies and the board member of the Syrian Forum, an organization that seeks to empower Syrians to take control of their own lives. He earned a Ph.D. in political science from UCLA. His dissertation was entitled Syrian Authoritarianism, Persistence or Change, and he has also served as the chief of staff to the Secretary General of the National Coalition of Syrian Revolutionary and Opposition Forces in 2012 and 2013. Following Dr. Ammar, we're going to have Yaser Tabbara, who's going to come up and give a presentation on the second report. He is the board member of the Omran Center for Strategic Studies and a strategic and legal advisor to the Syrian Forum. He has earned a JD, a Juris Doctorate, from Depaul University in Chicago and is a practicing attorney in civil rights and international law, and a managing partner at the Chicago-based firm ZKT Law. I want to welcome both of them, and I want to thank them for their leadership And there are tremendous efforts to try and improve the lives of Syrians who have both been displaced, but also refugees. Part of my initiative, the Muslim Diaspora Initiative, is to try and identify less suits, to use a crude term, in DC, and more folks who have deep knowledge and expertise and networks like they have. And I'm really delighted now to introduce and to bring forth Dr. Ammar. So please welcome. Thank you.
Hello, everyone. Good morning.
So I'll be looking a little bit to the screen, if you don't mind, so I can share a few thoughts this morning with you. I will be speaking on security governance in Syria. There has been several attempts previously to look at the security sector in Syria and how it will transform in the during the transitional period, and how do you tie this into the new context and the new realities on the ground. We at the Omran Center assembled a task force of former security agents, of experts, and have been working on this since last summer, and have issued our first study, which is with you today, and also the additional study, which is a shorter one that we have issued, to look at the evolving new security realities post 2011. So the context of this all is that there has been a narrative or a perspective that is perhaps more idealistic and more wishful thinking type of dismantling and of those types of approaches that have called for a complete revamping of the entire system. And although most Syrians would actually aspire to look for that, many understand the realities today in the region and the need for a true security transition of those while preserving the structure, the archive, many of the experiences that the Syrian security agencies, in addition to the evolving security agencies within the opposition, within the Kurdish areas, within some of the Samai-type self-governing areas in the south, also in the minority Druze areas in Sueda. So there has been some evolving realities on the ground, and this required us to actually present a more of a pragmatic type of an approach that calls for a gradual but systematic change in terms of the doctrine, the philosophy of the security, the function of security itself, from a doctrine of controlling society and controlling the minds and lives of the people, to actually preserving security and preserving promoting peace, civil peace, but also countering terrorism. And many of the security experiments within the opposition areas have been perhaps one of the most successful in countering violent extremism. So I'll start very quickly with some of the roles of the security agents in Syria has had in the past. And this is very important to put this in context of why it is important to actually implement this change in any type of negotiated settlement or any type of an agreement, whether Geneva 5, 6, or 7, or 15, at any type of an agreement between the Russians and the Americans, there has to be an agreement on a new security architecture that actually preserves the regional stability. And this is what the regime has been very utilizing its many security apparatuses to actually destabilize the region. To actually, you know, whenever there is pressure on the regime, they would put people in jail. Whenever there is, they want to impose some sort of security imbalances in the region, they'd let go of thousands and thousands of prisoners, and those end up in ISIS-controlled areas. And so there has to be a look at a real practical experience, whether those agencies today serve the stability internally, but also regionally, in the regional stability. This is a very, very, very simple type or simplistic type of what the current regime's security structure looks like. You have many dotted lines because there are four main agencies, officially at least. Those are the military intelligence, the Air Force, the general intelligence, and also the political security. Some report to the Interior Ministry, some to the Defense Ministry. All have access to the president directly. And I'll also report to something called the National Security Bureau, Maktab al-Amn al-Watani, which is headed today by Ali Mamlouk. We looked in our study in terms of how those four main official agencies have many branches that overlap one another, that actually spy on one another, that have overlapping jurisdictions, that aim towards actually controlling the public sphere, controlling politics, controlling the thoughts and minds, and there's just this great saying in the Middle East, not just in Syria, where the walls have ears. And then you have these auxiliary type of institutions, whether it be on the security and military networks, also official or semi-official, something that stems, there is a security apparatus that stems from the Republican Guard, from the 4th Armed Division, the new Tiger Forces that have appeared recently, and also the auxiliary, you have the Ba'ath Party has also security apparatuses that operate in the 14th provinces. And it's very important to look at this very wide network. In every province, there is something called a security commission that's headed by representatives from the four main official offices, but also headed by the governor and also by the Ba'ath Party branch in those governorates. And so you have this very wide, very complicated network. There is absolute powers ordained by laws and the Constitution awarding full immunity for any security agency to operate without being questioned, and this is in the Constitution, but also in many of the presidential decrees, and many of which are not allowed to be published for public distribution. You have a competing sense of loyalty between these agencies, so each agency trying to compete by having their loyalty to the head of the regime, and this is where they have access to submit reports to straight directly to the president, bypassing the minister, bypassing the Central Intelligence Bureau, and straight to the head of the regime. You have a compounded fear between these security forces impacting society and impacting each other, actually, in terms of this compound fear complex. You have duties related to the ruling. So there's this doctrine in Syria, in the security agencies, that their main objective is to actually protect and promote the head of the regime. And that's why many of those agencies, officially four, but practically over 18 agencies, it's more important of the person who's heading those agencies and not necessarily the institution. Sometimes the head could be a weak person from a weak family in the Alawite mounts. And so the deputy would actually have much more power than its head. And even sometimes the head is not important, deputy is not important, but actually the Ba'ath Party security type office would be the one that's calling the shots. Today, not many people defected from the security agencies because those are actually the ones that have been in charge of leading the opposition or the uprising file. And those are the ones that have been commanding the military units that are striking at opposition or at civilians all over Syria. And so there has been very minimal, perhaps not more than 50 defected individuals from high offices within the security agencies. There's an objective of restricting political activity to the minimum. There's an exhausting and overwhelming human capacity and bureaucratic structures. There's this thing called commissions, so you could be commissions outside of the HR books, basically, from one agency, from one ministry to be commissioned to the security agency. And there's this cross commissioning of individuals that are basically commissioned to go and serve in other agencies. The Air Force intelligence, for example, is mostly commissioners by members of the armed forces that are commissioned to become air forces, Air Force intelligence. And this is perhaps the most security agency that has committed crimes in the last 6 years, the Air Force intelligence. And mostly, unfortunately, composed by one sectarian group that represents the Syrian population. And that's also part of our study, was looking at the composition of who controls power within those agencies, and who are the ones that call the shots, who are the ones that control the strategy, if at any, there was a strategy. So there's like three layers of control within those agencies today. One is, again, the official, then the networks, and then the auxiliary institutions. There's a corrupt doctrine. There's this security philosophy that is not a sustainable type of a philosophy, that is not able to survive itself after any type of transition. And this is why it's important that any type of a settlement in Geneva or outside of Geneva has to include a security component, not just to protect the West from refugee outflow and ISIS, but also to protect the regional outflow of any type of security risk, is that there has to be a security architecture tied in with any type of a political settlement. There's this ad hoc provision overlapping, legalized repression by law. Sectarianism is a very important element within the security architecture today in Syria. There's this isolated type of islands within the security agencies that are that no one can touch, are untouchables. This is how today the security agencies have basically commissioned security functions to new militias within the regime. And this is, when you talk about fragmentation of the Syrian opposition in Western media, look at the fragmentation of the regime where now it has no ability to actually take back those functions. And so past, you know, we're not only talking about prior to 2011, but also the last 6 years, what has happened, what has taken place is that the regime has decentralized many of those functions, has awarded local militias the full control of those regions. And those are just a few samples, basically, of some of those militias. Some are Syrians, some are local Syrian Shiites, Syrian Palestinian militias. Today, we look at a new reality, at zones of control, zones of influence. You have military control layers, if you look at the map, and basically those controlled by perhaps the U.S. in the northeast with the SDF, Syrian Democratic Forces. You have the Southern Front controlled by the military operation room in Jordan, mostly Jordan and the U.S., but also some other countries that finance that. You have the Euphrates Shield in the north. You have Idlib and the other areas that are very contested by many groups in those areas, and it's not really a one-sided type of a control. You have no monopoly over security functions. Who operates as a security agency in Syria? Is it the regime? Is it the opposition? I think it's a very fragmented, and there's no monopoly at this point today. So there is a lack of central authority, and also this supports and weakening the security architecture all over Syria. What we proposed. This could be called a very idealistic, but perhaps a very practical type of an approach, is that those four main agencies in Syria need to be cut down to a central security agency that has like a national public security agency, a domestic arm, and a foreign intelligence arm. The military intelligence has to be merged with the Air Force intelligence agency, and all should be, today on paper, they claim to be reporting to the Defense Ministry, but in reality they don't. And so they need to be strictly reporting to the Defense Ministry and strictly with a mandate of only protecting the armed forces and the bases and the related military apparatuses, and not being involved in the politics, not being involved in the civilian type, in the civilian life of the people. So we looked at scenarios of an ad hoc type of transition or an orderly type or semi-orderly type. And this is also needs to be looked at geographically. Is it going to be taking place at the same pace and speed all over the geography of Syria? Or is it going to happen at different phases in different regions? So perhaps today the Euphrates Shield, the Turkish-controlled basically zone, has initiated and established security agencies in the north. The Southern Front has a security arm. The SDF forces, the self-administration, or the Northern federal self-declared federalism, also has those agencies. So how do we control, how do you transition this into a future type where you have some sort of functions of security that are awarded to the periphery, to the localized governance structures, and some that need to be kept in a central level? Those are the type of engagements and negotiations that need to take place, actually. So a sustainable transition process must be accompanied by a systematic change in those security services. This is if we want a sustainable peace process, if we want something that would work more than a day and then break out. This is where a step-by-step approach whereby let's do just the ceasefire and then we figure out about the next steps is a very problematic approach, because it doesn't deal with the realities on the ground, with the risks, with the threats that are causing this this very, very fragmented scene to actually not become uncontrollable. And this is where it's important to have this deep connection between the security reform process and the Geneva or the internationally led process of transition. Positive engagement is required from both international and regional actors. You can't leave one out of the picture, because there's spoilers, many spoilers, as we see, perhaps the most internationalized conflict that we have seen in the region. There should be some monopoly in the central state that has certain functions controlled by the center, but there should be also the new reality of Syria as a decentralized reality, at least in the governance and the local administration, and this is what Yaser will speak in the next session, that certain functions need to be. So in Jarablus, in the Euphrates Shield in the north today, they have a local police that reports and gets their salaries paid by the local council, the local governance council, and then they have a security agency that reports to the military at this point, and will transition into a new security agency in those regions. In the south, in the southern front, there's also a similar type of structure that's evolving. In the regime-controlled areas, it's becoming even more fragmented and fragmented, that it's become very much uncontrolled. And this is where, you know, the Russian proposal to do a fifth brigade and try and join some of those militias together so far has not reaped any benefits, in my opinion or my assessment. And so it's important that there should be some attempts to make some sense and consolidate many of those agencies. And basically, the regime is unable, as from a functional type, from a very, very pragmatic, sustainable type of an approach, not an idealistic opposition type of an approach, from a very need-based approach, the regime is unable to make this balance, unable to control those, because it has let go. It has given them so much power that they become a life of its own in the reality today. The assumptions today is that there are one of the very beginning assumptions of our study is that there will be a severe resistance by those agencies. And those agencies won't just give in and say, okay, I'm going to come and reform, because any reform to them means that they're going to give up power, and this is very and this is very threatening. It's an existential threat to them, and so this has to be forced somehow by a mutual type of an agreement on the political level, and then implemented in a gradual process in a three stage that we propose in our study. So transitioning to this new security structure, there's a new doctrine that needs to be developed, and this is not developed from day one, but it has to evolve. At least the path, the track, has to be set in the early stages of negotiation, and not just leave it to the Syrians will discuss it later on once they have a new constitution, because it's it has a very strong spoiling effect in any type of settlement. There's the need for professional training. There's the need to have transitional justice tied into this. There needs to be a rehabilitation of the entire structure of the security agencies. The objectives of this future security agency has to maintain that it will protect the citizens first and not the persons heading the state. And it has to preserve state institutions. And so the entire study that we're proposing is actually promoting the preservation of state institutions and not the regime that's controlling and that has hijacked those state institutions. This is one of our premises, the assumptions of our study. There needs to be a developing of professional capacities, working with many organizations that have worked on developing the real professionalism and not having security agencies with, you talk about the Air Force intelligence, the highest degree is perhaps a high school degree in there. And that this doesn't mean that we're minimizing the level of intelligence, but you're talking about high-ranking officials that really have no clue what, in the early stages of the uprising, you get stopped at one of those checkpoints and they tell you, do you have Facebook with you? This is the amount and this is 2011. This is not, 10 years ago when Facebook was not very much known. This is high-ranking officials saying, do you have Facebook with you? As if it's a thing that you carry with you. This needs to be a synchronization and collaboration with the justice sector. So one of the results of our study is that we look at the security sector per se, and we don't see a security sector in a definition type sector in Syria. We see security apparatuses that are operating in a very complex web of a network. And this network basically doesn't operate as a sector. A sector has a definition, a textbook definition at least, of a synchronized type of relationships, of an engagement with the justice sector, with the judicial system. You have the role of civil society organizations as a watchdog, as looking over the process of transparency. You have a congressional, parliamentary type oversight. You have this type of separation of powers, and this doesn't exist, obviously, in the Syrian case. So what we propose in our study is a three-stage type of an approach, or three phases, starting with the initial basically set of laws and constitutional declarations. So in whether there's a new constitution or a declaration of the constitution, there has to be some stipulations, some statements pertaining to the security, basically an incorporation, the rebalance, basically merging, as I mentioned, the military intelligence and the armed force intelligence, merging the political security with the general intelligence into one agency. Those are the type of approaches that need to be done from the early on stages. Some of the people need to be stationed in their bases so as to avoid furthering the bloodshed of what's happening. And then the next stage would perhaps be a more structural development and developing the institution, the sector itself, both in terms of human capacity, but also in terms of the structure of the organization, how it operates, the internal procedures and processes, the oversight of the parliament or Majlis Shab. And then you have the third stage, perhaps very complex. I'm very simplifying a long process of security sector. The third phase would be constructing the remaining components of a security sector, of a healthy security sector, and establishing complementary work conditions between security sector and civil society. This is a long process, but it has to start at least in the beginning to put the first alphabets, the first elements of a security architecture within the any type of settlement or resolution. And again, this is for practical reasons to make sure that this war doesn't break at any moment in the future, and that at least you'll maintain the minimum required type of stability and security during the transitional period. And I thank you very much for your attention.
Good afternoon. Thank you for having me. Thank you for New America and Dr. McKenzie for the introduction, and for New America for hosting us. My name is Yaser Tabbara. I'm going to be covering the second study that is the subject matter of today's talk. But before I do that, I wanted to make a couple of quick points about general points about perhaps the relevance of what we're talking about and about our perspective as a Syrian think tank. The Omran Center for Strategic Studies is part of a larger umbrella organization called the Syrian Forum, as mentioned by Dr. McKenzie. And the approach of the Syrian Forum, a 100% Syrian organization, is to perhaps bring back the agency of Syrian people against very, very insurmountable odds in a very internationalized conflict and context, and bring back some of the agency back to the hands of Syrians and try to empower them as much as possible. We work on empowering the Syrian individual, the Syrian civil society actor, and the Syrian local governing council. These are the three main elements of what we do. The other thing that we really need to make clear as at the outset of any presentation is the fact that the Omran Center and the Syrian Forum has this approach of, or makes this vital distinction between the Syrian regime and the Syrian state and its institutions. These are distinctions that the Syrian opposition in general has been described unfairly as incapable of making, and I submit to you that there has been work over the past 6 years of many of the opposition actors, including the Syrian Forum as a civil society actor, and the Omran Center for Strategic Study, where we make that distinction. We're vehemently against the criminality and the practices and the existence of the Syrian regime led by Bashar al-Assad and his cohorts, but we are very much pro the preservation of state institutions in Syria, and we feel that that is very extremely important in terms of a viable, sustainable political process moving forward. And I think the nexus of what we have to say today and to what is taking place nowadays in terms of the latest semi-clarification, if you will, of the American new American administration's position or plan on Syria. Obviously, nothing is clear yet, but that the missile attack against the Sheherat airport in Homs as a retaliatory measure against the chemical attack committed by the Assad regime is provides some measure of clarification on where we're going. And so within that context, we see perhaps the administration is pushing towards, again, sitting back at the table and forcing Assad and his allies to reasonably come to the table and talk about a sustainable political process that we could move forward, where prior to that, there has been talk about the rehabilitation of the Assad regime as a potential partner in the reconstruction efforts of Syria. And so we feel that this is a major turning point, and as such, what we have to present basically becomes even more relevant. And as my colleague, Dr. Ammar Kahf, mentioned, there is a major need for, there are Syrians right now that have been working on very practical issues of talking about reforming the security sector in Syria, talking about empowering local governance. And these are the two main files that we chose as the Omran Center and as Syrians to present or to work on for the past few years, and then to present our work to show that there is another way. There are many others that are working on very, very specific files and digging in the trenches and being on the ground and observing and coming up with recommendations in terms of moving forward, that we really need to heed these types of recommendations. And so, if anything, if we're to come away with any particular idea, what we want to assert to you today in terms of local governance is that for the past 6 years, there has been a local semi-democratic or democratic governance experiment and experiences that have been taking place in areas that are not controlled by the Syrian regime, by the Assad regime. And that experiment and these experiences are incredibly important tools to build on moving forward. And I don't think many people talk about these experiences, and we wanted to shed some lights on them. So my presentation is going to go through three main parts. We'll talk about the local administration councils. LAC stands for local administration councils distribution in Syria, in all of Syria. So the areas that are controlled by the regime and the areas that are not controlled by the regime, the areas that are controlled by the Kurdish forces and ISIS and other actors as well. And then we'll do an overview of the local administration councils in the opposition areas, because that is sort of our specialty. That's where we have our researchers and our people on the ground reporting to us and producing these types of studies and results. And then the third final section is the local administration council's positions on some very important issues that are taking place as we speak. So this is the map of Syria, and as if it could not be more complex than this, it actually can, and it actually is. So what you see here is, in terms of color coding, the military control, the groups that control these areas militarily. And so if we are to even be more accurate, we would even include different areas of control here in terms of American presence, in terms of Russian presence here and in Afrin. The yellow part supposedly is the Syrian Democratic Forces, or SDF, which are mostly controlled by the YPG, Kurdish militias. And then the green areas are generally, you know, those armed opposition actors. Some of them include, some areas include areas that are controlled by Nusra, which we do not count as in terms of our studies as quote unquote opposition. And then you have the red areas that are controlled by quote unquote regime forces, which is again is not very accurate, because the regime areas, the areas that are supposedly controlled by the regime, have been controlled by many different actors, including many local warlords that belong to the that manage militias that are allied with the regime and that belong to the regime superstructure. And then you have areas that are controlled by Hezbollah, and then areas that are controlled by Daesh, by ISIS. Now there's another layer of all of this. And that is the administrative layer. So all of this discusses the military sort of type of control areas. And then you have areas, for example, in Idlib, where some of the areas that are controlled by al-Nusra are not controlled by al-Nusra administratively. They're controlled perhaps just militarily, but then al-Nusra came to the realization that they could not engage in the management of affairs of people. And again, due to a lot of populist resistance and demand against the Nusra, local councils were established in these areas. And then you have other examples of different layers of control, administrative versus civilian, administrative versus militarized. All in all, in areas that are controlled by the opposition, there are 406 councils. Prior to 2016, that number was larger, but as the regime and the Kurdish forces and others took over some of the areas that are controlled by the opposition, that number dwindled. And that is sort of our universe, Omran Center's universe, in terms of tapping into, we have, you know, people on the ground, we have researchers, we have surveyors that have conducted many surveys and produced a lot of the studies that we're producing sort of the summary of today. So in terms of a comparative analysis between the nature of local administration in areas that are controlled by the opposition versus areas that are controlled by more extreme actors, and then we have four main basically comparisons. That's how we're describing local administration all of Syria. So you have areas that are controlled by the PYD, by the Kurdish forces, and then you have local councils or local administration on the regime control areas. Going back to the opposition areas, in 2012, as a state institutional vacuum basically was produced because of the lack of military control by the regime, activists basically came together in areas and decided to form coordinating bodies. Decided to form bodies that would govern the affairs of people on the ground. And that's sort of the grassroots nature of the commencement of local governance in Syria. And so we had many different experiments or experiences where you had areas that had a semi-elective process, some areas that had direct elections, some areas were appointed by, had appointments of the, you know, the main actors in the area to govern their affairs. But all in all, as you know, under-resourced and underfunded and chaotic as it was the first time in Syrian history in over 50 years where you had local democratic experiment, local democratic practices that never existed under the Assad dynasty prior. Where under armed group areas, the more extreme ones, you have limited legitimacy, you have ideological sort of type of objectives in terms of domination, in terms of control and administration. You have militarized governance similar to that of the regime in these areas. We felt necessary to also include the Kurdish areas and what sort of local administration structure they have just in comparison to the general context and the opposition areas. And as we know, it's a very polarizing political discourse that a lot of the Kurdish militias that are controlling that use, especially in areas that have majority Arab populations. With the exception of the canton of Afrin, there is a record of very poor management in terms of areas that are controlled by the Kurdish militias, contrary to popular belief. And then you have the areas that are controlled by the regime, where you have a decreasing centralized control, and then you have more chaos and more sort of security type of governance empowered by local warlords that belong to the network of militias that are allied with the regime. This is just a based on one of the Omran Center studies. I think you have that study outside. Basically, that went through the 406 councils and determined the percentages of how they came to being in terms of the process. And so 38% were actually the result of a direct election. We have astounding experiments of a peaceful transition of power, for example, in Aleppo prior to it being overtaken by the regime and its allies. And then we have Idlib is another example of several cycles of transition of power between councils that have been democratically elected. And then you have 57% that were put together by consensus, and then only 5% are appointments or activist individual efforts. The general overview of the local councils, these are the different layers that local councils belong to, and they tend to be parallel to the structure that the administrative structure that existed prior to the revolution. There are at the neighborhood level, the municipal level, the village level, and then the city level. And then above that, you have the governance level. Yeah, there are 14 governance in Syria. As discussed before, the emergence of these local councils came through the vacuum and through the realization that something needs to be filled. In terms of, and these are, this is again another study that was conducted by Omran. This is the, these are indicators or trends that we've identified in 2016 and 2017 in terms of, the trends of that local governance in general is moving forward in opposition areas. You have, a great level of inclusion, participation from activists to technocrats. You have participatory processes such as elections and so forth, and then you have access, you have transparency, you have relative access and transparency that was not there before. These are perceptions again back to the study that has been conducted that surveyed many councils. About how many councils were surveyed in this study? 105 councils that were surveyed across Syria. So you have, these are the perceptions of people to the role of these local councils. So you have 57% of people that were surveyed say that the role of local councils has been to provide direct services in terms of, picking up the trash and maintaining schools and wash programs, et cetera. And then 42% basically say that they have both political and service roles. In terms of taking political positions, issuing political statements, talking to armed actors in the area in terms of how these locals want to manage their affairs, only 1% saw their role as political, which is very interesting for us. This is the general functionality of these are the areas that local councils have been working through, and then perhaps as a nexus to what Dr. Kahf was talking about in his presentation, one of the services or one of the
functions that were identified through surveying both the councils and the people that were governed by the councils is a security provision section, which is heavily local and happens to be in collaboration with other local entities by establishing local police and things of that nature. Other current trends since 2012, 2011 until 2017, you have a rising trend of expanding the provision of services by these local councils to the populations. There is a move from just providing immediate relief to actually investing in infrastructure, despite a lot of the aerial bombardment and a lot of the really terrible conditions that they're working on. There is a trend of focusing on long-term infrastructural development. The sort of the more negative aspects is that they still are heavily dependent on external funding, although they are trying to move in the direction of revenue collection, and we have a few successful experiments in that direction, like local taxation and things like that in exchange for basic services. They have played a major role in housing a lot of the IDPs, the internally displaced Syrians, that you hear about, whether it's through a lot of the aerial bombardment by the Assad regime and their allies, by the ceasefire agreements that are brokered between the regime and their allies and some of the opposition areas where you have internal displacement and demographic shifts. So some of the local councils have been playing a crucial role in terms of managing the affairs of the IDPs. They have an increasing political role at the provincial level, at the governance level, they develop new localized pacts. Let me skip this because it was sort of covered and I think I'm running out of time. These are the three main, this is the last part of the presentation. These are the three main issues that were identified in terms of political trends, of the role of local councils in the political process, in any political process. The majority of the sample that we took, supports the hired negotiations committee, which is the body that is representing the opposition perspective in Geneva talks. The majority agree that Bashar al-Assad is and his circle and of people who are responsible for the industrial scale criminality that has been committed in Syria is the main issue preventing success of any negotiations. And then more than two-thirds of the sample prefers a more unified governing structure, but with somehow an administrative decentralization. So as you know, the decentralization spectrum it could be very wide, anywhere from sort of very light, administrative federalism to a very heavy political federalism. And so the majority tended to go to the right of that spectrum, closer to the right of that spectrum, about 70% actually. In terms of, again, making the nexus back to what's taking place, and these are going to be my closing remarks. The local administration councils and local governance in general has a very crucial role to play. The local governance experiment really has to be looked at very closely, at least in the areas that are controlled by the opposition forces. And they could be used as building blocks in terms of assuring a quasi-stable political transition in some of the areas that they control. Right now, we have a de facto federalism, or we have a de facto zones of influence that divide Syria. And so a lot of the political discourse that we hear out there is all about the unity of Syria and bringing Syria back together. Local councils can be the tools to actually stitch back that fragmented structure in very small, sustainable long-term steps in terms of providing basic services, in terms of strengthening the civil peace process between areas that belong between councils that belong border areas between two different zones of influence, for example. We've seen them play a crucial role in brokering and maintaining ceasefire agreements. They could play a major role in terms of transitional justice, in terms of truth and reconciliation, in terms of providing local security and disarmament of some of the local groups that govern militarily. They could generally promote the political process that we all want to see Syria going in the direction of. And these are some of the numbers that you'll see in the study in terms of what are the percentages of support or lack of support for the points that I've mentioned earlier. So in order for us to have some form of a sustainable transition that really deals with the complexity of the Syrian context and what has been taking place on the ground, at least in the areas that are controlled by the opposition, we really need to look at this experiment. This experiment can play a crucial role in terms of countering violent extremism in various areas. It has been the catalyst of pushing away a lot of the Qaeda groups and a lot of the ISIS groups and a lot of the affiliated groups to these armed actors. And as such, it needs to be looked at, and it needs to, we're not offering any instant solutions as some would like, but at least we want to start the conversation on the importance, the vital importance of the local governance experience that has been taking place over 6 years in order for us to build on it and move forward. Thank you so much for listening, and apologize for making it long.
Ammar, Yaser, thank you both very much for those very detailed presentations. I'm gonna kick it off here with a few questions, but I should add before beginning that this event today was planned long in advance of the horrific chemical gas attacks last week. And the reason I point that out is because these guys and their organization have been scope locked on trying to think about two big issues, governance and security, and sort of what happens when there is peace the day after. And so let me just start with sort of a big question two blocks away from the White House as this administration weighs its options. If there's one big idea you have for them to think about the day after, what should they be focused on? What is that one big idea?
Well, as mentioned earlier, the fact that there has been a local governance reality on the ground in Syria that provides potentially the essential tools to build on in terms of an electoral process that builds from the ground up, that you could build on in terms of keeping any form of peace agreements that could be built on in terms of being a tool to fight extremism in some of these areas, in most of these areas. So that local governance experiment has to be heeded and has to be looked upon very, very carefully.
I would say that there are reliable interlocutors. There are Syrian American advocacy groups that have been very successful, and there are experiences on the ground that cannot be overlooked. And repeating the mistakes of neighboring countries should not be done in Syria for the mere fact that it will backfire on everyone.
You mentioned that today that there are 406 local committees. Can you give us a sense of how does the regime view these committees compared to, say, the opposition, to ISIS, to other groups? How is the regime responding to them?
They form a direct threat to the philosophy of governing Syria. For the past 50 years, Syria has been governed with a very iron fist that has not allowed for any local participation or grassroots participation whatsoever. And so these local
councils, these local governing bodies, have been a manifestation of a democratic experiment. And so that, I think, presents a major threat to the Assad regime. But I would have to add as well that any political process that moves forward potentially, naturally, will have to bring some actors from the side of the regime that were not involved in the direct bloodshed. These actors would be interested in bringing some form of centralization or some form of unity to Syria, and these very actors that are very local could also be utilized to actually stitch back that fabric together that has been torn for the past 6 years.
To that point, let me ask both of you. I mean, this idea of organic local organizations that have sprung up as the result of the uprising, and as you've mentioned, that they are democratic to some extent, and they are taking place at a very local level, so they understand a full range of issues. Do you feel that the international community is engaging them to the degree that they should? Because it just seems like these are the kinds of organizations that could really provide deep knowledge on not just a political solution, but also a way forward, sort of the day after.
It's very important to first look at those formings, not as organizations, not as social gatherings or social clubs, not as NGOs, not as relief organizations, but as local governance structures that represent the people that are able to manifest local government on and local state institutions on the local level. So this is perhaps a perception change that need to be, or a paradigm shift that needs to be looked upon. And this, I think, changes the reality. When you treat them as NGOs, you give them aid or you award them, there is no recognition here. And it's very important to recognize that there is legitimacy rising from the elections, from legitimacy from the bottom up. And this is very important for stability.
Open it up to the audience now. I just ask that you state your name, your institutional affiliation, and questions only, please. So the gentleman in the back. Yep, we're going to bring you a microphone.
Thank you. I'm Case Bouchard, National Endowment for Democracy. Thank you for your presentations. I have a question for Dr. Ammar Kahf. In terms of security sector consolidation and reform, there are, as you said, a lot of presence of foreign militias now in the country, and it seems that there's sort of a plan to make them a more permanent fixture within the country. Is there any way back in terms of reconsolidating an only Syrian presence? Thank you.
I mean, foreign fighters, I don't think there's any way sustainable to actually integrate them into any DDR or projects. But I think perhaps local militias need to be somehow included, not those that performed any crimes against humanity, which is the majority on many sides of the aisle, but many of them need to be integrated in future military structures, security architectures, but also local police, local intelligence, and so forth. But foreign fighters really have no, those are the destabilization elements within Syria and in the entire region. And I think there has to be during the process of a settlement, perhaps the Russians need to be, to guarantee the exit of those elements.
Yes, sir. Chris Davis, retired Foreign Service officer. Is there a role for the Ba'ath Party once the regime is gone? Thinking back at the experience in Iraq, de-Ba'athification.
It's very important not to dismantle every institution in Syria, and many of the Ba'ath Party elements have defected or have sided with the people. Many of them have not committed crimes against the society, and so it's perhaps too early now to detect. But I'm at Omran, we promote the continuation of those institutions. Perhaps the isolation of elements that were part of the process of the former regime, But an Iraq example, I think most Syrians would not want to repeat the same repetition of dismantling the army or the security or the political structures. But there need to be an opening of political activity to allow all parties to be participatory into the system.
Yes, sir. We'll start on this side and just maybe work our way around.
Thank you. Steve Landy, Manchester Trade. One always hears the argument on television that if we leave Syria, it's going to be an unstable force and we'll end up worse. If Assad leaves, the Alawites will be in deep trouble, the Christians, and they discuss different minorities. My question is that given the spread or the existence of the LACs, which seems to be your building block for the future, are they in all of the, quote, different ethnic areas and so on? What happened, for example, in Aleppo when the, what happened to the structure in Aleppo when the Syrian army occupied or whatever they happened to have done it or not? In other words, is this a nationwide structure that we will build on, or will we start working in very local areas and then trying to expand them to the national area? Thank you.
So one of the, I mean, before answering your question, I mean, I want to tackle that myth that things could be worse when Assad leaves. And it's not an if for us, it's a when, looking more and more. It's truly one of the most destructive myths that have perpetuated the Syrian tragedy. And one cannot imagine anything worse than hundreds of people being gassed and to death, or tens of thousands of detainees that are being tortured as we speak to death in Assad prisons, areas that are under siege that have been under siege for months and years, demographic shifts, the major criminality that's being conducted on innocent civilians through Air Force and such. And so a lot of people invoke the example of Iraq and Libya, and we have come to the position or to this point in time in Syria that I could tell you as a Syrian, the Libyan scenario is actually looks like a very good scenario for me compared to what we have right now. And so I wanted to address that particular point. In terms of local councils are as building blocks, one of the major roles that these local councils can play is the reconciliation of a lot of the differences. And so when we see a de facto sort of divided Syria into different zones of influence, you'll see that on the borders of these zones of influence, you have a number of very important, potentially very important local governance structures that could actually engage in some form of reconciliation and peace. And we've seen some of these experiments actually take place in terms of some of these councils that have contributed to the preservation of ceasefire agreements and local stability. In terms of, I mean, there are issues. There are definitely sectarian issues, and there's definitely sectarian undertone to a lot of the discourse that is being used. But we see it more at the level of the militarized factions, more of the armed factions as opposed to the civilian structures that are governing the bodies. I mean, we've seen a lot of excellent examples of coexistence. For example, in Homs, our deputy director of the local council administration unit, one of the Syrian Forum's main partners in conducting a lot of this work and supporting local councils, is a Christian from War. And he was a member, he was one of many members of the local council in that area. There are several examples of Alawites or of Christians or Ismailis that are members of a lot of these councils. For example, the councils in Latakia have played a very crucial role in northern Latakia, when northern Latakia was with the opposition militarily. Played a very crucial role in terms of maintaining a peaceful and quiet relationship with their Alawite villages and counterparts in the areas that are controlled by the regime. So, yes, I mean, this could be an experiment that we could build on for sure. Is it going to be incredibly complex and complicated? Absolutely. But you know, give me solutions. I mean, that's what we're trying to do here. Yeah.
Let's just start here.
Thank you very much. Michael Kurtzig, retired from the U.S. Department of Agriculture and worked on food security issues in the Middle East. So my question is, does your study, and I haven't read, look at all at food security, economic recovery, jobs like this, or are you dealing strictly with the political side? Because this side could be even more important to feed the people and to make sure that the economy functions. Thank you.
Not in the study that I presented today, but at Omran, we have a track for economic development studies that with local administration. So we have issued a report on water security, on food security last year in 2016. And we definitely look at the security question in a comprehensive type of an approach that includes societal security, economic security, and the hard security type of approach that I presented today.
Yes, sir.
Thank you. Namo Abdullah, journalist with Rudao. What are your thoughts on PYD's experience of governance in northern Syria, in the Kurdish region of Syria? Some people believe that it has maintained a high degree of stability and order, a higher degree of stability and order compared to much of the rest of the country. Do you see it as a model for Syria? Do you agree with the argument that Syria has to be partitioned along ethno-sectarian lines?
Thank you. There is a problem in the governance structures in northeast Syria, controlled by PYD or YPJ or Syrian Democratic Forces, is that there is contested legitimacy within the Kurdish population that most of the Kurdish society does not agree with the governing structure that is actually controlled by non-Syrian elements. Most of the leadership, most of the crucial decisions are not from within Syrian leadership in those areas. On the administrative level, which we have studied the Afrin governorate, for example, that is quite different from the governance structures that are in the northeast part, mostly governed by the PYD. Afrin is always looked upon in a very different type because it's the northwest tip of Syria. And it's quite different, meaning it's more successful perhaps because of a lot of local, because there's ceasefire, there's local agreements within society, and perhaps the foreign elements are not very much interfering. On the northeast tip, I think it's very problematic. I think there's no elections taking place. One of the things that in opposition areas, local councils operate within very similar administrative laws and procedures to that of which the regime operates in. In the northeast PYD governed areas, those are run by new laws that are just uniquely their own. And this really further fragments Syria and further develops, I mean, they operate under the commune type, communist type of a governance structure. There's huge problems in terms of service deliveries, water, public construction. We looked at the education sector in the SDF controlled areas. A lot of problems in that, more than what the opposition areas are facing in terms of curriculums, in terms of funding, in terms of number of students enrolled. We looked at the construction industries, how many construction jobs have it created, and also there are problems in terms of basic public services within those areas. And I think there's, and then the societal security type where, the practices of the PYD in those areas have been very much, there has been many reports on human rights violations. There has been many reports in terms of oppression of the Kurdish National Council's groups and parties. And there's no room for any political activity by anyone except that of which it is approved by the foreign elements within the PYD. I mean, if it was Syrian elements that are reconciliatory with the local elements, then that would be a different type of an approach. But those are the foreign elements within this region that is controlling the shots, that is gaining basically legitimacy by the use of force. Turkish, Iranian, basically some of the PYD leadership that from Kandil that are basically calling the shots sometimes. On the local level, there's a split between local administration that is not very authorized to do a lot of the decision-making processes from day to day. The governing structures where you have ministries, multiple ministries, and you have this overlapping mandate within those ministries, the commune system, if you're familiar with that, a very old type of governing on the local level, those are very problematic, and those are not conducive of sustainable societal peace or societal security.
Yes. Right in front of the gentleman.
Olivia Barrett, George Mason School of Conflict Analysis. More of a historical question. In terms of the interagency hostility you talked about between intelligence agencies, was that more of an accidental progression, or do you think that was a conscious effort by Assad to sow instability so that the other, like, the only constant would be his leadership?
I think the security architecture in Syria was mastered by Hafez Assad, the father, and he was the only one who controls the code to understand how it operates. And so there are certain branches that are reserved to certain family members within the Alawite sect. I'm sorry to speak from a sectarian, but this is how he appointed certain branches to certain, or allocated certain branches to be headed by certain family members within the mount that he comes from. So, I mean, even within the Alawite, there's contested legitimacy also that very few Alawites are involved within the regime. And it's not an Alawite regime, perhaps it's an element within the Alawites. There are certain families that are selected by the father to formulate this architecture, and basically that all have some sort of loyalty to the head of the system, which is the Assad. And so yes, I think the father architectured it in a way to preserve his rule, and that's one of the ways that he was able to sustain his rule for 40 years. And the son perhaps did not understand this code very well, and that's one of the reasons why this system basically broke down.
Yes, sir. Isam Kayar from SAMS organization. So looking at your both studies, actually, so one focusing on the security, how it stands today, and the other one is about the civil society buildup. But going back to your first question, is the day after, is there any envision? Because I think when something major happens, let's say, you know, you're going to replace leadership or you're going to replace regime, the first worst question comes is, how is, because security is the first thing is going to be disrupted. And you're saying, even though the regime has so many sects and so many fragmented, but at least it looks cohesive, at least from the outside, they're able to maintain security and day-to-day operation, whatever that system looks like. But the moment something happened, then that fragmentation is going to be like massive. So I think the first thing is, how do you address the security situation on day off? Is there any plan, or what would be the practical way? Is like, okay, you know, this is the security, how it's going to be? Because I think one of the concerns that one of the gentlemen said is what's going to happen to the areas which are right now relatively safe, or there's no conflicts, but then when security is disrupted, then what's going to happen on the local level when you don't have centralization? So what kind of, is there any vision for how is the security going to be addressed when that major things happen, and how are you going to build on it? Because I think that's the major things. I mean, building civil societies and governance, those are kind of like comes after, like, you know, on a long-term basis. But the biggest concern is that security and instability, because that's when you kind of lose control of everything, you know, and sometimes could be irreversible. So.
Can I just tackle the first part of this question, and then maybe I mean, what I want to do is I want to challenge the assumption that you're building the question on, and that is that the Assad regime actually has the ability and the capacity to ensure some form of societal security in areas that it controls. And I submit to you that the capacity of Bashar al-Assad to continue a security hold on certain areas is comparable to for example, Jaish al-Islam's ability to keep security in Eastern Ghouta, or Nusra in certain parts of Idlib, or other armed groups, let's say the Southern Front. In these areas, the most threatening element to people's security are the barrel bombs that are dropping on their heads from above, and a lot of the military belligerence that has been taking place by the other side. Obviously, there are internal fights and things of that nature, but we've seen a number of different experiments, of contexts that do not belong to the regime and the control of the regime, where, you know, the type of security is maintained. That's one thing that I want to challenge. The other thing that I want to challenge is that we don't see a scenario where you have a day after. The scenario of a day after is I think long by gone now. What we potentially will see is some form of a transition that will include different elements of different sides, potentially focusing on certain areas and then bringing these areas back together. I don't know if you want to.
I mean, that's one of the assumptions that needs to be looked upon is that will there be a day after in the traditional type 2012 view of a day after, where there will be a clear day zero and a day after, whether horizontally, geographically at the same time, or whether vertically in terms of all state institutions transitioning to a new phase. I think what we see now today, at least at the trend, is that there are isolated zones within Syria, and those have developed security apparatuses to ensure security transitioning. I mean, there has already been a transition of power and of security and of governance in the Southern Front for the last 2 years, maybe. There has been a transfer of security and governance in the north, in the Euphrates. There has been also perhaps a contested one, but a reality also in the northeast in the SDF-controlled areas with all the problems, but there has been some sort of a transition. And so I think the trend that we're seeing is that those zones will come together during a political process where all of them will, you have these five security, if you may say, security agencies. There will be 600-700 local councils from the different controlled zones. Those are the ones that will form the general assembly of local councils, perhaps and form a higher council of local administration. And so this is the type I think these are the scenarios that are in the foreseeable future, regardless of how this evolves, whether Geneva 5, 15, or whether it's an international agreement outside of Geneva, and then Geneva is just the vehicle that will move that agreement through.
Syria. So the first one is when the city of Idlib was kind of got out of the control of the regime, so you can take that as a day after, and then Aleppo, but maybe more clear is the Idlib example. And when you look at, yes, eventually the local governance kind of kind of stabilized, but when you look at the days after, you have a massive refugee and people migrating out of those areas, running out with their lives. You have looting for people like take advantage of each other and steal others' properties. And you have chaos. So I don't think you can ignore that. And these are small examples in the local areas where a lot of people that we know and we talk to that they say things are really bad and chaotic, and people they just leave and go to different areas, either the villages, so they evacuate. And some of them, they don't come. So you lose some of the population. So I don't think it's fair to say that the day after doesn't happen or the locals are ready to take over. Unless you have a seamless plan or something that really ready to take over, you're gonna have to accept that there's gonna be a period of instability and chaos, and which could be dangerous because you can never guarantee the outcome if it's really major scale. If you look at the major scale, I'm just looking at local areas.
I guarantee you there's not gonna be any seamless transition anywhere, and there's gonna be a lot of chaos in any transition. But the two examples that you gave in terms of a day after are not applicable to the general scenario, because what you assume is that armed opposition will take over Damascus, and I don't think that's a possibility, at least not anytime soon. So again, I would challenge that presumption. But I understand the point that you're making in terms of having some form of a structure or some form of a plan to preserve some form of security in a transition of power period. What we're assuming is that if a political process actually produces a plan assuming the status quo right now in terms of zones of influence, and then working up from that reality towards re-centralizing the state slowly but surely. And I think that's where the local governance structures can play a role in terms of that stitching, that long-term stitching of Syria back together, if that makes sense.
We have time for just two more questions. The gentleman in the back. Actually, can we take the questions before you respond? Maybe we'll take three, just so I'm...
Stanley Kober. I keep hearing this term political process, and it puzzles me. Look at the American Civil War. Abraham Lincoln tried to prevent it by appealing to the mystic cords of memory that would bind Americans together. Didn't work. United States was held together not by a political process, bloodiest war in our history. The North won, not a political process. If I look for a parallel in China to what's going on in Syria, it's China. That wasn't a political process. After their revolution, which seemed very democratic, you had warlords. Mao Zedong said, political power grows out of the barrel of a gun. That's how they ended all the civil wars. It was a decisive military victory by the Chinese Communist Party. Can you provide an example of this political process you are talking about?
Based on agreement.
Let's just get okay. A few more questions and then we'll, yeah, no yeah. Problem. Just the gentleman right behind her first and then, sorry, and then you. Thank you.
Warren Coates, retired from the International Monetary Fund. I was a member of the Coalition Provisional Authority in Iraq as senior advisor to the Central Bank of Iraq. And the scariest thing I heard while living there occasionally, too often, in fact, was, whoopee, we have a blank slate, so we can just put in the right institutions. So I totally applaud your perspective, your approach to preserving but reforming the leadership of existing institutions.
Thank you. Yep, thank you.
Thank you. I wish you'd speak a little more, Eva Havas, a little more about how the interests of outside powers like the U.S., Iran, Russia, is going to affect any political process you might implement. And also, I haven't heard any discussion of what we do about all the refugees and displaced people and what plan there would be for returning some of them.
Okay. No, you go ahead. We've got, if you can respond to those as best you
two
can
questions.
In a few minutes. Yes.
Go ahead. Dayton, you said.
Well, in terms of the first question, I mean, no one would want a decisive victory against a regime that practiced industrial scale criminality for the past 6 years more than Syrians, more than us. Syrians with conscience, as I'd like to describe, because I cannot speak on behalf of all of Syrians. And yes, I find it very appropriate to judge here Syrians that do not have that position. But the reality of the situation, that's not going to take place anytime soon. And the conflict has been heavily internationalized to the point where Balances of power have been, we've seen it over and over again. We've went through cycles of opposition getting close, and then, you know, Russia getting involved, Iran getting involved, Hezbollah and other actors to sort of, you know, bring back the balance of power. We've seen it even, you know, at the hands of the Obama administration when the first chemical attack happened in 2013, and when we all thought that we're very close to that transition, and because of the obsession with the Iran nuclear deal, you know, that administration was very willing to negotiate away the lives of hundreds of thousands of Syrians that they could have preserved, in my opinion. But in terms of an example, you know, you have the Dayton Agreement. You have examples of civil wars or internal conflicts that have been resolved, via political process. Not necessarily a very fair one, but a political process nonetheless, when international powers decided that enough is enough and we need to move forward.
Let me just follow up with one question that the lady had in the front about refugees that we talked about earlier that maybe one or both of you could just touch on, which is maybe something that might be overlooked, is the role that the local committees could play in trying to help refugees repatriate at a time when they want to voluntarily repatriate.
Sure. I mean, one of the major examples that we have right now as we speak, I mean, as I said in my presentation, local governing structures or local councils have been playing a crucial role in terms of providing services for internally displaced Syrians from areas that are either they've been demographically, you know, forced out of, or areas that they suffer intense bombardment on. But also, we have a very unique experience or experiment that is taking place right now in the Euphrates Shield area, where close to 50,000 Syrians have been reported to be repatriated back into towns like Jarablus and Bab, Azaz, Rai, where you have now heavy investment in building infrastructure for a lot of these immigrant communities or refugee communities to go back to it. An organization like ours is heavily invested in keeping Syrian talent and Syrian brains as close as possible to the Turkish border should a moment of repatriation happens. And for example, Dr. McKenzie mentioned one of our projects called Rizq for Professional Development. We have caused the employment of over 7,500 Syrians across Turkey, ranging from day laborers all the way to doctors and engineers and anywhere between, males, females, from all over Syria, placing them in the Turkish job markets. These people are going to stay there. They're productive members of society now. They're not going to, chances of them leaving and going to Europe and the West are a lot less, and chances of them being repatriated and rebuilding and participating in the rebuilding process is a lot higher. So these are some of the thoughts that I have on that issue.
Thank you. We're going to have to conclude right here, but I want to thank both of our speakers for a very bracing conversation. But I'd also like to tell you that moving forward, we certainly hope to have you back. And on a personal note, as a director of a new initiative looking at Muslim diasporas, I certainly have a personal and professional interest in trying to do everything we can to tap into the wider Syrian American community to hear their voices and their experiences, because they really do have profound ideas on how to move forward. And they might not always agree, as we saw today, but I'll tell you, I think this kind of healthy dialogue and these kind of ideas, an exchange of ideas, we need more of, and I certainly think our government would profit from these kinds of ideas. So please join me in thanking our two speakers.